Hello, this is Myra Elaine on the Buying Space Channel. Today, I'm doing the Adult Bible Studies. We are in the unit called God Provides for Fall 2023. The first unit was about food, the second about water, and the third is about shelter. And this Sunday, my Sunday school teacher will be teaching from Exodus 29. Now, I'm not going to read Exodus 29 for two reasons. I don't read Exodus in the adult Bible studies because I'm reading through the Torah and I'm in Exodus. So, I'll eventually have a video on Exodus 29. And also, I don't read because I don't want to step on or duplicate any Sunday school teacher's lesson, because when they do the lesson, they're going to be reading from Exodus 29. So I never read the focal passage or the background passage, because this is what the direct Sunday school lesson will be about. If you want to be involved in this study, find Enoch in the Methodist Church and find the Sunday school teacher in their church that uses the adult Bible studies. And if you live in Jacksonville, Florida, email me. My email address is on my about page, and I can get you in for the Zoom or for the live Sunday school classes. So we are in, we have a choice of Romans and Isaiah, which is split up. Jeremiah, Isaiah, Leviticus, two readings from Leviticus, and Deuteronomy. So, I looked and read all these passages, and none of them spoke to me, or I wasn't led to any of them, but I liked all of them. So, I don't know. Let's just pick Jeremiah, because Jeremiah, I read Jeremiah 31 the other day, so let's go ahead and go to Jeremiah. Now, this is a new King James Version of the Bible. The Methodists use the Common English Bible a lot. My Sunday school teacher uses the Jerusalem Bible. I don't know of any version of the Holy Bible that Methodist have anything against. I think the new international version is used a lot as well. And it's fun to compare versions of the Bible. But I got this Bible from Melanie Lightbeam and I love it. I hadn't had a new King James Version. I had access to one for over a year and a half. So, 29, 4 through 14. And this Bible's great because it's got Robert Schuller and Paul David Dunn put together this Bible, composed the formatting, underlining. They have lessons. It says, open your mind to God is a lesson in here. But I'm going to get on to the reading first. So the first part, the first three verses, are just a background that this is a letter. So in verse 4, it starts the letter. Thus saith the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, to all who were carried away captive, to all whom I have caused to be carried away from Jerusalem to Babylon. So this is about the Babylon captivity of Israel. Build houses and dwell in them. Plant gardens and eat their fruit. Take wives and beget sons and daughters, and take wives for your sons and give your daughters to husbands, so that they may bear sons and daughters, that you may be increased there and not diminished. And seek the peace of the city where I have caused you to be carried away captive, and pray to the Lord for it. For in its peace you will have peace. For thus says the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, do not let your prophets and your diviners who are in your midst deceive you, nor listen to your dreams, which you cause to be dreamt. For they prophesy falsely in you in my name. I have not sent them, says the Lord. For thus says the Lord, after 70 years are completed at Babylon, I will visit you and perform my good word towards you and cause you to return to this place. For I know the thoughts that I think towards peace and not of evil, to give you a future and a hope. Then you will call upon me and go and pray to me, and I will seek me, and you will seek me and find me when your search for me with all your hearts. I will be found by you, says the Lord, and I will bring you back from your captivity. I will gather you from the nations and from all the places where I have driven you, says the Lord, and I will bring you to the place from which I cause you to be carried away captive. I lived at a place, and from the moment I moved in, I started talking about moving. And I didn't really want to be there. And at the time, I had no faith. And I had very little hope about the future because of where I was. And so I didn't try to grow. Now, I'll be honest with you, I lived, but I didn't live a life that was pointed towards the future. And I didn't plant many plants. I had some plants given to me, just because they were given to me, I planted them. And I ended up having a lot of nice, lush plants at that place. I planted two trees, and the neighbor ran over them with her car on purpose. I planted a bunch of amaryllis. And we're talking like 50 amaryllis bulbs. And one of the neighbors stole them. I planted a Japanese hedge bush below a window that was a security risk. And I had another neighbor destroy it. So it's not a good neighborhood. There were lots of people around us that had an animosity towards us. And so I didn't want to be there. The neighborhood didn't want me to be there. It was an odd neighborhood. I like a neighborhood that's racially mixed. And but the problem was with this neighborhood is, even though it was half black and half white, and the hope is that people learned to get along, the white people that were there were racist, a majority of them. And so we had African-American people, and then we had white neighbors who flew the Confederate flag. And this is a neighborhood in Jacksonville, Florida. So me being white, when I would go out into the neighborhood, the African American people would assume that I was racist because I was white, because the majority of the white people that lived in that neighborhood were Confederate flag wavers. So we weren't treated well by either part of the community. There were some people that got to know us, and we did have a few acquaintances, but where we lived, a lot of people moved in and moved out very quickly because of the type of neighborhood it was. So I never fully worked towards the future at that place. And this letter is telling the Israelis, live here, work towards the future, even though you're in captivity, even though, you know, and have hope for the future. Because God wanted his people to grow and live and thrive, no matter where they were. And that's such good advice for life. No matter where you find yourself, what circumstances, fully live, fully have hope for the future. Of course, they got a letter that said in 70 years, this will end. And I don't want you at that end of 70 years to be diminished. I want you to be prepared to go back to what was promised you. Now, 70 years, even with the long lifespan in the Bible, that means that a generation or two might be old. Their third generation might be old, and the first two might have passed. So, to have, you know, great-great-grandchildren that can go back home was the goal. And to be a thriving, faithful community when you do that. So people today are very short-sighted and are miserable if their life turns to circumstances that are not pleasant. Being hauled off in captivity is the worst thing I can imagine. I know people, there are a lot of people in the world these days that are refugees, and they end up living in these camps in tents. And but when that happens, they just do, if I don't know, if that happened to me, I would just start using whatever was around me to improve my life immediately. Now, would I have done that when I was younger? Maybe not. And another thing that happens is people come along and hand you weapons to fight when you get in that situation a lot of times. And it's globally, refugees are being manipulated to a great degree. And it's not a good situation. And I think this letter has a lot of wisdom in it, that when you're in that situation, or you're just in a situation in life where you're in a neighborhood, I would love to be in a racially mixed neighborhood, but not one at odds with each other. One is that is at peace, and where people are educated to the other's needs and why doing certain things is not okay, and they are learn to adapt to that, which was not happening in my old neighborhood. But I was in a neighborhood that was not at peace with itself. When Trayvon Martin murderer was acquitted, I was driving my minivan down the street, and this older African-American woman shot me the bird. I was there during the entire trial, hoping the man would go to jail, that he would be punished for killing Trayvon. And then when he's given a pass for killing Trayvon, and the day that I'm sad, the whole neighborhood pretty much is sad, because I'm white, I'm given the middle finger. when I would have done just as much as that woman that gave me the finger to see justice done. Let's not hate each other. Let's not make assumptions about each other or stereotype each other or discriminate against each other at all. Let's love each other and build our neighborhoods and have hope for the future. Just because something happens in Sanford, Florida, doesn't mean the rest of Florida has to behave that way. And wherever you are, whatever state you're in, if you have a tragedy like the tragedy in Maine, that doesn't mean there's going to be a mass shooting tomorrow somewhere else in Maine. It's a rare instance. Now we need to do everything we can to make sure that that rare instance does not happen again. Don't get me wrong on that. But we don't have to live like it's going to happen tomorrow or next week or next month. As I hear people talk about how we have to live in fear here in the United States. Mass shootings, even though they're more common, they're still a rare instance. And vote and work with your politicians, be involved in your government to make those changes. If you're already involved in your government for personal reasons, add a word about how you feel that can be prevented or what needs to be done. Or for God's sake, pray and let your opinion be known. It's okay to let your opinion be known. And if for some reason that kind of talk gets you in trouble on one social media, take it to the other social media. I've had people say to me, this isn't Facebook, this is YouTube. So I have Facebook. I haven't been politically active because I've been so busy producing videos on my YouTube channel. And there's certain things I can't say on YouTube. But I will say those things when given the opportunity and the place. I don't think that God wants us to sit around and cry for children. Yes, cry for children when children are killed. Absolutely. But do what you can to make sure it doesn't happen in the future. But also have hope for the future and don't live in fear. And don't let fear control you. And the politicians and the radio stations and the media all control you with fear. Or they try to. I don't sit around here having half a heart attack all the time because what the 6 o'clock news tells me or whatever time we watch it is not just at 6 o'clock. But you know what I mean? Don't live in fear. Live in hope. Even if you are in bad circumstances yourself. But just because you see somebody get smacked on TV because they're like you, doesn't mean you've been smacked. You personally have not been smacked. The person on TV was. And the millions of people that are like that person, if you all react like you've been smacked when you haven't, we will all have hope taken away from us. So live life from your own personal experiences. Yes, react to that person being smacked. Say, oh, that's wrong. But don't take it upon yourself that you have been smacked. Because you haven't been smacked. Have a wonderful and blessed day. And I hope I've said a few things that speak to some of you. And how we can carry on, hopefully more peacefully.